This coverage is brought to you by Sherwood Engines, Amigos Tequila Beer, Jordan Road Servicing, Swift Leisure Group, Robinson Road Planing, MotorsportsOpticians.com, Skipton Ford, and RallyPrep.co.uk. Welcome to our coverage of the DMAC Tyres Carlisle Stages Rally, round 3 of the West Wales Rally Spares RAC Championship. And if you don't remember what it is that makes historic rallying so exciting, then just take a look at this film that our cameraman Robert Walters has put together for us. So let's just remind ourselves how this series works. The RAC Championship is slightly different from other historic rally championships in that it allows entries from cars built before the end of 1986, with 7 different series in all. To give as many different types of two-wheel drive cars as possible the chance to compete in a historic rally. Series 1 is for cars complying to MSA historic regulations built before the end of 1967. Series 2 is for cars complying to MSA historic regulations built between 1968 and 1974. Series 3 is for cars complying to MSA historic regulations built between 1975 and 1981. And this is where many people's favourite car, the Mark II Escort, would run. Series 4 is for pre-86 cars complying to the slightly different FIA historic regulations. While Series 5 is for pre-87 cars complying to MSA historic regulations. Series 6 is slightly different in that it allows pre-81 cars that the organisers deem are not quite to historic spec. While Series 7 is for any two-wheel drive car that was built pre-87 and is in effect an open category of the type seen so successfully on the Roger Albert Clark Rally since its inception 10 years ago. And as we came to this, the third round of the West Wales Rally Spares RAC Championship, we can see how well this whole system works, with the points positions looking like this, and Martin McCormack and Phil Clark in first place in their Series 3 car, with a mixture of cars from Series 1, 3, 4, 5 and 7 behind them. The first running of the DMAC Tyres Carlisle stages had found a good base for the event in the grounds of RJ Murray and Sons, the haulage contractors, whose 30-acre main depot is in Longtown, just a couple of miles from Carlisle, and had plenty of room to contain a rally. The event itself would be split into two loops of three stages, with the first two stages of the day being the fabulously named Arthur's Seat, which was just over 4 miles long, followed by Newcastleton at just over 7 miles long. And it was the welcome sight of Ian Beveridge's Volvo, making his first appearance in Series 1 in the RAC Championship, that led that series away. And next along was Stephen Higgins, following on in his two-stroke Saab, which still seems to be a bit of a handful on the stages, to be honest. But Higgins and co-driver Howard Allison seem to be enjoying themselves. Of course, everyone was excited that after the earlier rallies, Martin McCormack and Nick Elliott were out to do battle once again. But for many, the appearance of this car on the stages was just as much a cause for excitement, being driven by former BRC champion and WRC driver Tapio Laukkanen, driving a DMAC tyre-supported Mark II Escort. Laukkanen was, of course, a major star in the BRC in the 90s, arriving on the scene with a bang in 1995, and so nearly winning the Scottish Rally with driving like this. And indeed, he was leading the event until he crashed with only a few stages to go. Laukkanen, of course, went on to win the championship in 1999, and here he was back into Kielder and the Scottish Forests once again. Running behind Laukkanen on the road was championship leader Martin McCormack. Thank you. Driving like this, it was McCormack who sneaked into an early lead. And next along was Nick Elliott, who was starting the event in a good mood. And after the first couple of stages, he would find himself in second place. Jason Pritchard and Dale Furness had a fast start, although it was not without its dramas.
Slow in, 5 right half long and 12 left. On the power. That's the way.
But they were quick enough though, and soon settled down into third place. With poor Matthew Robinson retiring on his way to the first stage, Tim Pearcey was next along and told us about his plans for the day. Said that, and despite looking really quick, Pearcey was down in 7th place after the first two stages. It was great to see Matt Edwards and Sam Collis starting really strongly, and they were 5th on each of the day's opening stages to lie in 5th place overall. This was a perfect antidote to months of stress for Edwards, and after a steady run to 9th place on the Tour of Hamersley, a good turn of pace as well. Highest placed of the Series 2 cars early on was Richard Hill. Hill, like Edwards, has had a torrid time with mechanical problems over the last year or so, but a change of luck seems to have come his way at last, and he was on dazzling form again, leading the series by 35 seconds after two stages. Rob Smith was going well also, in a Mark II Escort again, but still using one of Grant Shand's Rally Extreme cars, and enjoying the experience. Smith hopes to have his own car out in the next month or two, so that's something to look forward to, as you know that it will be well prepared and probably very quick. Dylan Davis had his car running in the top 10 again, but this is a Mark 1 Escort that doesn't qualify as an historic car, because it has an engine and various bits of transmission that are more in keeping with a long distance rally car than a historic stage rally car. One of the great things about the West Wales Rally Spares RAC Championship is to see people who had rallied in the past making a reappearance. Drivers such as Will Nichols, for example.
Well done. 500. Keep going. Into crest, 40 down, turn square left. You'll see it, you can see it taped. Turn square left, into K right, don't cut. 60, 6 left, into small crest, 6 left here.
So we asked Championship coordinator Colin Heppenstall just what it was that was making the Championship so popular.
Into 6 left, so K right, into 6 left.
So bump, 3 left, over small crest, 100, 3 left, over small crest, 100, 3 left over bump, 60, 5 left, and double caution, turn 6.
And what about the future for this particular rally?
6 right long, double caution, 40 down, 3 right,
6 right plus in that road. And 2 left, Max into 1 right, Max 30, 3 left plus, into 5 right, don't cut over crest, tightens, 12 left plus.
And what about the chicanes that blight so many events in the Kielder Forest
six
complex?
Right, plus half long, 2:15, slow in, 1 right short, sudden turn, square left. Stop your pitch. 16. 1 left of a bump, don't cut, and 4 right tight.
An interesting fact about events like this is that crews are not allowed to wreck the stages beforehand and use pace notes that they have prepared themselves. Instead, using subjective route notes and a safety DVD that have been pre-prepared by Patterson Pace Notes. And Jimmy McRae explained the benefits and disadvantages of that system. Sponsors of this new rally were obviously locally based DMAC Tyres, the company that was only started 3 years ago by Dick Cormack, and yet is already supplying tyres in the WRC.
Yeah.
we talked to Dick Cormack about the company's short but successful life so far. And in addition to sponsoring the event, of course, D-Mac had brought Tapio Laukkanen along as well. So how had that come about? What does Dick himself think about this championship? In the classes, making the best start in D3 was class leader at this point in the championship, Peter Smith, who now with 2012 BHRC Championship winning co-driver Patrick Walsh alongside him, seems to be driving with a lot more confidence in 2013. With the youngest pairing in the championship, Ben Mellers and Alex Lee, just behind them, and continuing to pick up speed with each round. While in D4, the early leader was Tim Mason, his white Porsche looking and sounding great, but seeming to be as much of a handful as a Porsche always seems to be on gravel. While only 1 second behind Mason after two stages, was the rarely seen Sunbeam Lotus of Guy Anderson and Kim Baker. And it was good to see this pair out again and setting such competitive times. Series 5 at this time was a sole preserve of Simon Wallace and Graham Ride, their rare BMW 325i sounding almost as good as Tim Mason's Porsche, and for a lot less money. It was good to see a nice variety of cars on this event, with Terry Cree's BMW 2002 showing much more pace this season. Will Midgley and Paul Slingby's Toyota Corolla was running in the Open Series 7 section, and another Alpa Cadet, this one being driven by Ben Welsh with Ben Cohen alongside him. Although when I say being driven, I do use the term loosely. Of course, one of the most distinctive cars in British rallying is the Steve Perez Lancia Stratos, which sadly broke down shortly into the first stage. And we asked him if he only kept running the somewhat troublesome car merely to keep the spectators happy. But are there any development plans for the future? As most people know, Steve also rides a Ford Focus World Rally car. We asked him if the Stratos was a lot harder car to drive than the Focus. I think we already knew the answer. As well as competing himself, Steve is a strong supporter of junior rallying through his Kick Energy Drinks company. So does he think that we need to continue to support rallying? So let's just hope that Steve Perez never loses faith in the Lancia Stratos. Stage 3 would follow, and after it, the only service of the day. And this was a great stage with nearly 11 miles in Kershaw Forest. And as we approached the halfway point, the class and series positions looked like this. Steve Higgins and Howard Allison were leading the B1 class, their Saab not missing a beat so far. Ian Beveridge and Paul Price were heading both Series 1 and Class B4 by a considerable margin, with the Volvo crew always seeming to be really competitive when they appear. Event clerk of the course, Colin Heppenstall, had taken the decision to let the 1600cc cars run at the front of the field with the Series 1 runners in order to get the best of the road conditions. And running absolutely first on the road helped Robin Shuttleworth and Ron Ruffhead to be leading in Class C2, while Clive Alcock and Richard Horton were leading Class D2 in a car that you don't see very often, a 1600cc Talbot Sunbeam, which is certainly giving Clive an interesting ride. Leading C3 was Dick Slaughter, and we asked him how his season was going so far. But to be fair, Dick is worth watching too, and he would hold a 7-second class lead after three stages. And it was Terry Cree who was pushing him, the BMW seeming like a different car in 2013. Peter Smith and Patrick Walsh had been leading Class D3, but were being chased hard by Ben Mellors and Alex Lee. And when Smith spun in Kershaw after his tyres had gone off, it was all that was needed for the youngest pairing in the championship to slide into the class lead. D4 was at this time going the way of Tim Mason and Graham Wilde, the Porsche driver still working hard to get the best out of the rear-ended monster. And although Guy Anderson and Kim Baker were just dropping back a little bit from the Porsche, they were in turn easing away from third place, Steve Magson and Jeff Atkinson. After the early demise of Dylan Davis with a cracked roll cage, it was Barry Jordan and James Grattan Smith who were leading Series 7 for any two-wheel drive car built before the end of 1986, which allows cars like Jordan's to run with any type of engine, and 2.5 Millingtons, Vauxhall and even Honda S2000 engines are the sort of power supply that you might see both Jordan's car and second place Martin Hawkswell and Nick Welsh's car. With third place in this series going to Will Midgley and Paul Slingsby in their Toyota Corolla at this time. But at the front of the rally, Marty McCormack and Phil Clark were still continuing to dominate the event. And after another fastest time over the 11 miles of Kershaw, they would take a 20 second lead into the midway halt, and we spoke to several of the front runners there. So at the halfway point of the D-Mac Tyres Carlisle Stages Rally, the leaderboard looked like this. Stages 4 and 5 were a repeat of the first two, but a complete change in the weather conditions meant that they almost felt like new stages.
K left, 40, turn 6 left tight, and 6 right over don't cut. 80, care ahead, 6 left long, tight, and to medium left tightens. Medium left tightens, 40,
And for Nick Elliott and Dave Price, this brought about an unusual problem.
Right one. 40, right 5, 130. Left 3. 80. Don't cut right 1. Don't cut right 1. Left 5 long, 100, right 3 plus, right 3 plus here, 60, left 6, 40, right 6, 100.
And yet despite this, Elliott and Price were only 3 seconds slower than the fastest man here, Marty McCormack. Jason Pritchard had no such problems though, and 3rd and 4th fastest over these two stages would see he and Dale Furness holding on to their third place overall and the lead in the FIA class. Behind them though, there was a stunning battle between Matt Edwards, Tim Piercy, Rob Smith and Tapio Laukkanen, as over the first two stages this foursome had set times that were only a couple of seconds apart. And then over the next few stages, it remained really close as well, but with Edwards just starting to ease away a little, so that even though the gap was only 1 second after four stages, a fantastic time only 1 second off Elliott's was enough to give Edwards a 13 second gap back to Piercy after the first five stages. Piercy himself was probably going just as quickly as he wanted to, and although he was dropping back from Edwards, he was starting to ease away now from Rob Smith, who had had a bad time on stage 3, but who was right back on the pace now. But having an even worse time was Tapio Laukkanen, whose escort had stalled on a hairpin on special stage 5, and he dropped at least a minute, being passed by Marty McCormack's escort.
Acute right aft tightens. 80. Flat, 2 left, into, flat 1 right, don't cut.
And although the car and driver were soon back up to speed, they were now somewhat disappointingly out of the top 10. So in 6th place at this time, and the clear leader of Series 2, were Richard Hill and Dave Robson, the Mark 1 escort crew right in the thick of things time-wise and with a 4-minute lead in the series. Next along were Will Nichols and Nick Broome, who were second in Series 4, the FIA Series, and happily swapping times with Jimmy McRae and Tapio Laukkanen, and I bet they never expected that. While as the day went on, it was McRae himself who was moving steadily up the leaderboard, and although he hasn't got the ultimate pace that he had 30 years ago, it's clear that he's lost none of his guile and consistency. James Potter and Bob Duck were next in line, they too showing their usual unobtrusive consistency to hold on to 10th overall at this time. Leading D4 now were Guy Anderson and Kim Baker, who had taken the lead from Tim Mason after Mason had had a bad time on stage 5. Guy and Kim won D2 in the BHRC in their Talbot Sunbeam in 2011, and won Category 3 on the 2011 Tour of Flanders Rally, but they had had a big crash on the 2012 Boucle de Spa, so it's nice to see them back on the pace again. Steve Maxson and Jeff Atkinson were third now in D4, a really bad time on Kershaw, having spoilt their progress on this particular rally. And in Class D2 at this stage, it was another Sunbeam leading, this the 1600cc car of Clive Alcock and Richard Horton. But sadly, they were just about to retire from the event. While in D3, Ben Mellers, one of the least experienced drivers in the championship, was just holding on to his lead from Peter Smith, one of the most experienced drivers in the championship, and it looked like this battle was going to go down to the last stage. And although there was little doubt that Smith was trying, he was only 1 second quicker than Mellers on stage 4, but was 2 seconds slower than him on stage 5. Holding on to third at this time in D3 were Alan Hughes and Richard Wardle. In Series 2 and Class D3, Dick Slaughter was truly on great form on this event and had a 1 minute 11 second lead in the class with driving like this.
One left over crest and four right. 40. Crest middle and stay right, slowing into six left, opens long. 40. Three right through long through post. Four, yeah. 40, three left long into one right, 80. So three left long, one right, 80, acute right, double caution.
And although struggling to match that pace on this event, Terry Cree and Richard Shores were still comfortably in second place in the class. And in this really competitive class, David Kirby and Chris Rixon were holding on to third, with Simon Pickering and John Brindley being another crew to rue a bad stage 3 time, which dropped them down the field from an early second place. Untroubled in C2 still were Robin Shuttleworth and Ron Roughead. With Nick Jarvis and Craig Thorley lying in second in C5 behind the flying Richard Hill. And let's not forget Series 1, where Ian Beveridge still held a strong lead and was having a great rally. With Stephen Higgins and Howard Allison still holding on to their Class B1 lead, despite coming fairly close to dropping it into one of the ditches here. And in the Open Series 7, Barry Jordan was extending his lead with each stage after a strong performance. With Martin Hawkswell and Nick Welsh. Will Midgley and Paul Slingsby. And Alex Lund and Nick Kitching following behind. Lund and Kitching were going really quickly, it has to be said, and would have been in second were they not to be yet another crew to have had a shocking time in Kershaw. Unless spare a thought for those running in the toughest class of all, D5, where even getting into the top 10 was hard. And here we have Tom Coftrey and Jamie Edwards. Rob Weir and Ben Giles. Andrew Robinson and Nigel Boston. Our TV partners Phil and Mick Squires were next up, with possibly the hardest worked and heaviest of any of the Mark II cars currently competing. And they were having a good scrap with our other TV partners and brothers Mark and Ed Bentley, who, if rumours are true, are gearing up for yet another attack on the classic Safari Rally. Tim Freeman and Ashley Trimble, who were just a handful of seconds behind Tapio Laukkanen with 5 stages gone. And now for our special stage of the week, let's join Jason Pritchard and Dale Furness as they tackle the 4 miles of Arthur's Seat.
4 left tight turns into 6 right tight. 80. 3 right, 60, middle of a jump, 200. One right, max in trees, 200 line. And the two right, fast in, maybe, 100. One right, slow in, 60. Care, five crest, five right.
So after one right, five.
Yeah, 60, 50. Yeah, slow in, crest, care. Five right, 60. Five right, 40. Six right plus. 40. Two right max, 130. To four left, 80. Six right, don't cut. Into two left, fast, long, 100. Four right plus, short, fast, 60. One left, max 40. One right, max 100. Turn, square left, tightens. Well done. 100. Six left plus. 40. Six left plus. And a three right, two left. And middle of a crest, 30. Six left, fast lane. 600 of a small crest and jumps to care, big crest and jump at forest, slow in 60, turn, 6 left half long, tightens.
Oi.
Well done, tightens, 60, 5 right plus, don't cut. A four right plus short, and two left, 40 past junction, to two left short, max 100, to two left 40, slow in, three left, six right, don't cut. Forty, square left plus, go, 350. Middle of a small crest, 250. Remember, slow in on the right to square right. 200. Go on. Square break. Into one right. And small crest, 60, care. Four right, five left plus, 300. Six left, 80. To six right, tidy, 200. Five right plus, the five left plus fast, 200. Five left half long and square right. 100. Six left, 20. Three left into five right, and six right over junction. 60, middle of a flat crest jump, 80 through dip to turn, six left over finish, and two right opens long. Well done.
And for our archive feature of the week, we feature the 75, 85 and 95 Scottish Rallies as a tribute to Tap Your Life With Us. We'll be right back. And so we came to the final stage of the 2013 DMAC Tyres Carlisle Stages Rally. And let's run down all the class and series winners. In Class B1, it was Stephen Higgins and Howard Allison who kept going and took the honours there. With Ian Beveridge and Paul Price winning Class B4 and Series 1 after a faultless performance. Robin Shuttleworth and Ron Ruffhead managed to hold on to their position of first on the road and were first in C2 as well. In C3, it had obviously all gone perfectly so far for Dick Slaughter and Tim Sayer with fastest time on every stage. So they set off on the last stage, Kershaw, at unabated speed.
Into one left, 40. Two right long, 40. Two right, two left. Into one right, tight and slowing to six right. No! Oh, that was lucky.
And such a simple accident, with no apparent damage to the car, luckily, meant that they were out of the rally. Which of course let Terry Cree into a lead that he had no time to lose. And it was he and Richard Shaw who finished up as comfortable winners of C3 rather than Slaughter and Slayer. With David Kirby and Chris Rickson taking a well-deserved runner-up spot. And Simon Pickering and John Brindley coming home in third. In C5, it was Nick Jarvis and Craig Thorley who took the runners-up spot. But they were no match on the day for the Series 2 man in form, Richard Hill, who along with Dave Robson took a fairly dominant class and series victory. And at the end, we asked him how his day had been. The open class, otherwise known as Series 7, went the way of Barry Jordan and James Grattan Smith, who didn't put a foot wrong all rally, and were rewarded with series fastest times on every stage. And you can't ask for more than that, can you? Martin Hawkswell and Nick Welsh finished just behind them, and looked fast all day. But they were just not on the pace of Jordan and Grant Smith on this event. And in the FIA series, Will Nichols and Nick Broome went just as fast as they could to take second place, but they couldn't match the times put in by series winners Jason Tober Pritchard and Dale Furness, who dominated the class. In D3, with there only being a 5 second gap between them, both Ben Mellers and Peter Smith were ready for a great last stage battle. But while Mellers was getting on with it, Smith was having problems.
Three right in, long of a crest, and a sudden six left. 170 down mid. Six right in.
We're going to have to stop.
Okay, six right in.
We have no engine.
That's okay.
And with the car being parked to avoid any serious damage, the way was clear for Ben Mellers and Alex Lee to take the class victory. With Alan Hughes and Richard Wardle taking the runner-up spot here. In D4, Tim Mason and Guy Anderson started the last stage quite close to each other as well, with Anderson holding a 5 seconds lead. But here a great drive from Mason despite a Porsche that was smoking quite badly, was enough to allow he and Graham Wilde to take the class win by just 4 seconds. So let's hope that we see more of Mason and Anderson over the next few events. And finishing in third in D4 were Steve Magson and Jeff Atkinson, who at least came away from the day with one fastest class stage time. And on to the overall results. And just outside the top 10, after an entertaining day for both him and the watching spectators, was Tapio Laukkanen. As well as taking second in the FIA series, Will Nicol and Nick Broom took a share of 9th overall, with a time of 50 minutes exactly, after matching times throughout the day with James Potter and Bob Duck. So there was plenty to keep those two crews occupied for the whole event. Jimmy McRae and Pauline Gullick had been running at the same place as Nicholas and Potter in the morning, but in the afternoon they picked up their pace and bit by bit moved into 8th. With Rob Smith and Alan Cook taking 7th, and only a bad time in Kershaw to blame for them not getting a better result after a fast and spectacular performance. As well as taking victory in Series 2, Richard Hill was pleased enough to be 6th overall, but sadly he didn't get another trophy for that. Tim Pearcey and Neil Shanks were 5th overall after their rally-long battle with Matt Edwards and Neil Shanks. After the first loop of stages, they were leading by 2 seconds, but Edwards pulled away with some really fast times in the afternoon. Edwards was of course thrilled with his performance, finishing 4th overall and 3rd in D5, and matching and beating some of the fastest names in the historic rally, which isn't bad for a man who was doing his own servicing and slept in his van in order to keep the cost down. And in case we forget, this was only his second rally in the car. Well, I'm impressed anyway. Third overall were Jason Pritchard and Dale Furniss to add to their FIA series win. And in second, after not being able to match Martin McCormack on these northern stages, on which he goes so well, were Nick Elliott and Dave Price. But second is no disgrace, and Nick had a smile on his face at the end. And as Elliot said, it was Martin McCormack's rally with stages that really suited him. So let's join McCormack and Phil Clark as they come to the end of the final stage of the event.
Hairpin right, drop outside.
I'm enjoying this bit.
Hairpin right, yeah. Drop outside. Nice and neat. Yeah, me too. 150 up the middle. Turn 6 right tightens. Loose maybe. 100. 2 right pass long, don't cut 40. 2 right, 2 left. Into slowing, one right tightens long into caution. Watch this one now. Six right double tightens, deceptive here. Six left tight narrow, six left tight narrow. 130. Five right plus over crest and middle over small crest into dip. Mid small crest dip, three right over crossroads and crest goes two right long over crest, don't cut, and airpin left, and airpin left. 60, small crest, five right, small crest, five right, 250 down the middle. Right into turn square left plus, don't cut. Remember, it's going to go four right first. Into turn square left, don't cut. Four right, don't cut. Four right, don't cut. 80. Four right slowing into tight five left. Into square left, don't cut. Square left plus. So it's going to go left again, don't cut. Six right opens, 40. Two right over small crest, into sudden six left plus. Two right over small crest, sudden six left plus. 80, slippy ahead. Six left long, tight, don't cut. And six right plus. Six right plus, 250 down the middle. 250 down the middle now. Two left long over finish, logs continue. Then 80, two left long over finish, logs continue. Then 80. Okay. Well, if you're not going to try, I'm not going to bother. Well done. Well done.
And so this is the result of the 2013 DMAC Tyres Carlisle Stages Rally. And as for the championship positions, they look like this, with Martin McCormack and Phil Clark holding a comfortable lead over Jason Pritchard and Dale Furness at the moment. And so that's it from the first running of the DMAC Tyres Carlisle Stages Rally. So let's finish by letting Martin McCormack and Phil Clark serenade us.
That was the Dubliners, Ed McCormack and Pete Clark.
Yeah.
This coverage is brought to you by Sherwood Engines, Amigos Tequila Beer, Jordan Road Servicing, Swift Leisure Group, Robinson Road Planing, MotorsportsOpticians.com, Skipton Ford, and RallyPrep.co.uk.